hearts open wide as the sky. We lift you high. It's real simple. We lift you high. Hands up, hearts open wide as we cry. God, we lift your name high. Let's sing that together. Hands up.
Hearts open,
hearts open,
wide as the sky.
Wide as the sky. Father, we come to lift you high.
We lift you high.
We come to lift you high.
We lift you high.
Hands up. Come on, raise them.
Hearts open,
hearts open,
wide as we cry.
Yeah. you for joining us for our midweek word. Now, let's go to Bible study.
Today, we're going to talk about the Beatitudes, the pathway to blessedness. And this lesson today is going to be coming from Matthew chapter 5, 1 through 11. But the meek will inherit the land and enjoy peace and prosperity. So meekness means to no longer operate in your own authority, but under the authority of God. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. What do you hunger for? Do you as Christians still hunger and thirst to feed the desires of your flesh? To hunger and thirst means to desire something greatly, a single-minded force and ambition. What we hunger for drives our actions. We go after that we hunger for. I can remember as a child, one evening, I wanted some cookies. And I cried and I told my dad, my dad had already gone to bed. And I just had to have some cookies. And I cried, you know, because I was just thirsting and hungering for cookies. You know, I thought that I wouldn't make it through the night if I didn't get any cookies. My dad had mercy on me. He got up out of his bed and he went and he got me some cookies. And so to hunger and thirst for something is to like, you know, I can't survive without having it. Where do you look for satisfaction? Do you look for satisfaction in the Word of God? Do you look for satisfaction in your prayers? Or do you look for satisfaction from your job, from your spouse, from your children, from your friend? Where do you look for your satisfaction? Is it still the things of the world, or is it lie within the kingdom of God? Are you seeking the holiness of God? Or are you still straddling the fence? One day, yes, next day, no. Is your mind being renewed by the Word of God, and does your love for Jesus Christ sacrifice motivate you to continually seek after the righteousness of Christ? To hunger and thirst for righteousness is to desire the kingdom of God, to seek first the kingdom of God. It means you desire God's will more than your own will. The essence of hungering for righteousness is having a sacred desire to identify with Christ. That is the foundation of our faith. We are made righteous when we accept Jesus' gift of salvation. To desire righteousness is to desire the life of Christ as your own, which comes through emptying yourself, sanctification, transformation, and holiness. This process is through the work of the Holy Spirit, but we must yield our will to the Holy Spirit. So to hunger and thirst for righteousness is to daily die to self so that the Holy Spirit can regenerate the Spirit of Christ in us. When I think of a hunger and thirst for righteousness, I think of Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I have been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. To thirst and hunger for righteousness is to desire the Holy Spirit working in you to produce the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Paul desired righteousness of Jesus above all. In Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 through 10, Paul says this, "What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. The righteousness that comes from God through faith, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, because like him in his death, and so somehow to obtain to the righteous resurrection from the dead. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. There is a common expression that we all have heard. Grace is when you get what you don't deserve, and mercy is when you don't get what you do deserve. When you have received the mercy of God through salvation, you will be merciful and not judgmental, critical, or analytical towards others. When we receive mercy from God, our natural response should be to extend mercy to others. Jesus gives a parable of the unmerciful servant, Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 25. And let's just go to Matthew's right quick. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times should I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven? Have you ever asked that? How many times do I need to forgive this person? Jesus answered, I tell you not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. The servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged, and I will pay back everything. The servant's master took pity on him and canceled the debt and let him go. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarios and grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, be patient with me and I will pay you back. But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said. Look, I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have mercy on your fellow servant just as I on you? In anger, his master turned him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart. So to be merciful is to extend what God has extended to us. God has been merciful to us. He was so merciful that he gave us his only begotten Son, that whomever believed in his Son and confessed his Son and believed in their heart that Jesus had died and that he rose on the third day would be saved. So why should we be so slow in extending mercy to others? God extends mercy to us daily because it says goodness and mercy follow us all the days of our lives. In this parable, the master had mercy on the servant and forgave him of all his debt. But this servant, he did not pass that mercy on that he had received to the one who owed him, but through the man in prison. Mercy cannot flow through selfishness and pride. It flows through the grace of God shown through his forgiveness of our sin. A person can perform merciful acts, but not be merciful. The Pharisees were good at performing merciful acts, but they were not merciful. They were not merciful people because mercy and grace cannot come out of a proud, selfish people. Rigidity, intolerance, judgmental attitudes, and condemnation flows out of them, but very little mercy. We desire God's mercy daily, so let's be merciful to others. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Pure in heart is not a heart of perfection. And let me say that again. Pure in heart is not a heart of perfection. It means to be free from distractions, to be free from anything that gets more attention than your relationship with Christ. The affection of a pure heart is fixed solely on God. A pure heart comes from an abiding, intimate relationship with Christ. A pure heart is not divided between the riches of the world and God. Based on 1 John chapter 2, 15 through 17, a pure heart is one who does not love the world or anything in the world. There is a difference between having a clean heart and a pure heart. All of us who have embraced the Lord have a clean heart. But a pure heart is one not distracted by the things of the world. So a clean heart comes through Christ Jesus and the Holy Spirit. But a pure heart, that responsibility is on you and I. We have to make the choice to have a pure heart. And we do that by not allowing distractions of the world, or not desiring things of the world more than we desire the relationship of Christ Jesus, more than we desire advancing His kingdom, more than we desire living a life of Christ. The pure in heart should see God because their undivided attention is on God. Their mind is empty of the distractions of the world. Psalms 24, verses 1 through 6 declares a person who's pure in heart. And let's just turn to see what David says right quick. And he reads, "The Lord, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For He founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in His holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to an idol, who swear by what is false. He will receive blessings from the Lord and vindication from God his Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek Him, who seek your face, O God of Jacob." And this is Psalm 24, 1 through 6. So a pure heart is one that desires the things of God. A pure heart is one who no longer desires to fulfill the appetite of their old nature. And as you can see, as I'm going through the Beatitudes, that one leads into the next one. We started out with the poor in spirit, and that leads us to salvation. And then after salvation, we become one that mourns, that are quick to confess our sins to God and who share with God, you know, how we are feeling and we are honest with God. And then from mourning, it leads us to being meek, to our meekness, to giving our power over to God and coming under His authority. And then as we grow in meekness, that lead us to desire and hunger for righteousness. You know, we want to walk in a right way. We want to walk upright before God. And then the righteousness producing us a pure heart. And that is, we no longer desire the things of the world. Now we desire that of the Father, and we want to be upright before Him. And now as we are pure in heart, as we desire the things of God, as we desire the kingdom of God, as we desire His word, as we desire to be in an intimate relationship with Him, as we desire to live the life of Christ, that brings us to peacemakers. "Blessed is the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God." Now, after I did the study on peacemaker, I had to ask God for forgiveness because I had the wrong mindset of peacemakers. You know, for a peacemaker, I look at, you know, you avoid conflicts, you know, you don't ruffle the feathers, you just let it go. But that is not the definition of peacemakers. Peacemakers do not avoid conflict in order to have peace. The world definition of peace is to avoid conflict, to never resolve issues of the heart. In fact, we are told not to talk about those things that may cause a conflict. The church at times choose to handle conflict by avoiding issues and pretending everything is fine. Pastors will avoid teaching the absolute truth of God to avoid conflict. This is not the peace that Christ gives. Jesus wants to go to the heart and deal with the real issues. Anything that fails to get to the truth and resolve the problem is not peace. The role of a peacemaker is one who brings grace and truth into every situation and offers the power of Jesus, the Prince of Peace. To be a peacemaker is to be a mediator and resolve conflicts between estranged parties. I have a friend, and I has attended several of her women conferences, and the first time that I fellowship with them, I noticed a unity among them that is rare to see. So I mentioned it to her pastor, and I was talking to him, you know, and I told him, you know, the unity that your women have, you know, it is a blessing to see. And, you know, and I asked him, you know, how, you know, and he told me something that I hadn't heard before. He said that whenever he hear of a conflict, he always bring the parties involved into his office and they discuss it and they talk about it and they resolve it. So he is a peacemaker. He said that he does not allow anything, you know, to fester in his church. You know, whenever he hear of a conflict in his body of Christ, he bring it to the forefront. He bring the involved body parties into his office and they talk about it and they resolve it. How often do we see that in our churches? Blessed are the peacemakers who wisely consider what truth needs to be told and who then to do so with love and season their speech with grace. Today, we need peacemakers in the church. We need peacemakers in our homes. We need peacemakers on our jobs. James chapter 3, verses 17 through 18. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy, and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. Let me say that again. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. The next beatitude is blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you, disciples, when people insult you, persecute, and falsely say all evil kinds of evil against you because of me. Jesus says, rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12 says, yes, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. Persecution arises when the Spirit of God in you is at work with the spirit of the world in others. Christian persecution encompasses any hostility experienced from the world as a result of one's identification as a Christian. You are mistreated because you display the kingdom characteristic described in the above verses that I've already gone through, Matthew 5, verses 3 through 9. And some people will not like you doing so. If you are willing to be rejected by men, to be accepted by God, then guess what? The kingdom of heaven is yours. Persecution is a reality of kingdom life. But the Bible tells us that God will deliver us out of all of them. Living a life that is free from conflict may indicate that we are compromising. There are two roots of persecution. One is from the world that is in the church, and the other one is from the outside world. I remember when I first accepted Christ, God led me to a book. And the name of the book is The Combat Zone by Rick Renner. And when I first picked up the book, you know, I was excited because I thought it was going to share, you know, how to deal with sent people on the outside, you know, how to deal with people that were still in the world. But to my surprise, The Combat Zone was a study on the people in the church, how to maneuver, how to deal with the combat zone in the church. It was the Pharisees, scribes, and chief priests that opposed Jesus and the disciples. You know, as we have studied about Jesus and his teaching, they were always challenging him. You know, they were always questioning him and trying to trap him. The Pharisees, the scribes, the chief priests, the one who studied the law, knew the law. The opposition from those within the church represent those whose heart has not been changed. They study and know the word of God, attend church faithfully, pay their tithes, serve on ministries, preach the word of God, teach the word of God, while yet denying the power of God to change their heart. Their agenda is not advancing the kingdom of God, but their pride and power. The second opposition would come from the outside world. When the church is following the Lord's leading and actively partnering with him in his work, this opposition comes from the army of Satan, with him being the commander in chief. Jesus says, "Rejoice, for he is able and will deliver us from all persecution." Also, Jesus tells us to rejoice because the kingdom of heaven is ours. We have an eternal home in heaven. Paul's response to persecution and our response to persecution is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. The Beatitudes are the godly attitudes that will lead to happiness and fulfillment. Poverty of spirit, mourning over sin, meekness that no longer struts but submits to God's control, hungering and thirsting for righteousness, mercy, purity of heart, peacemaking, and persecution is the pathway to happiness because of God's favor. The Beatitudes lead us to yield to the guidance of the Holy Spirit and producing us an abiding relationship with Christ and the kingdom of God. They yield a life of Christ-likeness in each of us. As we grow in each Beatitude, we grow to reflect our King's culture, values, morals, nature, and lifestyle. We advance the kingdom of God by replicating and reproducing his will on earth as it is in heaven. And that is what God wants have called us to do, to live a life that brings forth his way, his kingdom, God desired for all of us to advance his kingdom. He desired for all of us to die to self, to lay down our own will, and to pick up his will, to pick up the life of Jesus Christ. As you study the Beatitudes, as you examine yourself by the word of God of the Beatitudes, notice, you know, where do you need God to strengthen you? Is it mercy? Is it meekness? Is it to change your desires of your heart to, for you to desire, you know, the righteousness of God and no longer desire the things of the world? Is it to be a peacemaker? Have God called you to be a peacemaker? But most importantly, to recognize that without Christ Jesus, before we come to salvation, that we are poor in spirit, that we have no power, no authority within us to do anything that is right in the sight of God. Thank you for joining us this evening. I pray that something was spoken to you today that touched your heart. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you, oh God. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you that God, as you have called us into your kingdom, oh God, Heavenly Father, we do not have to guess. Heavenly Father, we do not have to assume, oh God, how you want us to live. Heavenly Father, you have laid it out in your words, oh God. Heavenly Father, you have laid out your purpose for us, oh God. And Heavenly Father, that is, oh God, to show forth your kingdom to others so that others may come unto you, oh God, that you may be able to draw others unto you as you have drawn us. Heavenly Father, we just want to say thank you, Heavenly Father. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. Heavenly Father, thank you right now, Heavenly Father, for your love, oh God, because your love is better than any. It's greater, your love, oh God, because Heavenly Father, you are love, oh God. Father, thank you for your long-suffering towards us, oh God. Through your mercy, oh God, comes your long-suffering. Heavenly Father, for you do not desire any of us to perish, oh God, but you desire all, oh God, to have everlasting life through your Son, Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we ask, oh God, that you forgive us of our sin. Father, give us of our unrighteousness, oh God, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Father, forgive us, oh God, Heavenly Father, when we seek after those things that are not of you. Father, forgive us, oh God, for when we are not merciful unto others as you have been merciful unto us, oh God. Father, forgive us, oh God, when we operate in our own strength and our own power, oh God, without, oh God, acknowledging you, oh Lord, and for you, oh God, to handle all issues in our lives, oh God. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for your Holy Spirit, who is our comforter, the one that regenerates the life of Christ in us as we yield our will to him. Father, I just want to say thank you right now, Heavenly Father, for all that you do. Thank you right now in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, your love is great. Your mercy is everlasting unto everlasting. And again, thank you, O Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.
We hope that you have been blessed by this message. We'd love to hear from you. Click on the Contact Us link on our website homepage. If you like to give to this ministry, visit nationsport.org and click on the Give tab. You can join us live or online on Sunday and online next Wednesday. Have a safe and blessed week.